Hello, my name is Alan Remaley. I'm a senior investigator at the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, which is part of the NIH, where I'm very fortunate to be able to do research on how fats like cholesterol and triglycerides cause heart disease. But before I tell you about my research, I'd like to make just a few general comments about science that I've learned over the years, but has been true since the 1600s when Francis Bacon first described the scientific method. The first is, like most other human endeavors, it's usually very useful to collaborate with other people, particularly when trying to make progress in science. So along the way, I'd like to point out a few key people in my own research. Secondly, science can be very unpredictable, which makes it both frustrating and exciting. Research sometimes on obscure topics, or in my case, in a rare disease, can sometimes uncover unexpected findings that may have more broad application. And then finally, as you'll see, it's always a good idea to understand when your experiments don't work, particularly when they provide information that's counter to what you think should happen, because many times this offers the best opportunity to learn something new. Now, the inspiration for my research came from a chance encounter with a patient. She was a young woman, had a disease called familial hypertriglyceridemia, which just simply means her triglycerides in her bloodstream were too high. And triglycerides, like other fats, don't dissolve well in water, so they are transported in the blood in very small particles called chylomicrons. And when they're present at very high levels, they can clog small blood vessels and damage the pancreas. And unfortunately, this happened to our patient. And when she asked me, you know, what we can do to help her, I didn't have a good answer, because there's not a specific treatment or cure for this rare disease. But it motivated us very much to work on this problem. Next, we did something that we could have never done even just a few years ago. With the help of Dr. Rich Pastor, who's a friend and another senior scientist here at the NIH, we used a very powerful supercomputer called Anton-2 to try to understand how the protein that's defective in our patient, called APOC2, serves to act as a stimulator of LPL, which is the plasma enzyme that degrades triglyceride in the bloodstream. Using this information, Dr. Andrew Wolska, a very talented research fellow in my laboratory, she first designed and then synthesized a very small piece or fragment, which we call a peptide, of the larger APOC2 protein. And she showed that this small peptide was actually more potent than the full-length protein in activating LPL. And then we were very thrilled when we made a genetic mouse model of the defect that our patient had, and found that our peptide actually blocked the accumulation of triglycerides in the mice. But as I said earlier, science can be very unpredictable, and it was at this point in our research where we had a very perplexing finding. When we tested the peptide in other mouse models of high triglyceride, it always worked, whether APOC2 was present or not, which indicated it may be working by another mechanism. And the clue to understanding this puzzle is that many important metabolic steps are regulated not only by activators, but also by inhibitors. Dr. Dennis Sviridov, a very talented biochemist in my group, then was able to demonstrate that the peptide blocked the inhibitor of LPL, which is called APOC3. And this was an unexpected and very fortuitous finding, because in late-stage clinical trials, other drugs that block the inhibitor of LPL seem to protect against heart disease by lowering cholesterol. So even though we did not intend to do so, we developed a peptide that had a dual mechanism of action in lowering both triglyceride and cholesterol. So the peptide was recently licensed to a major pharmaceutical company. And I'm very optimistic one day, with probably a lot more hard work and maybe a little bit of serendipity, that we will have a new treatment for our patient with high triglyceride that may also turn out to be useful for the many patients with heart disease that have too high of cholesterol. So I'd like to finally finish with a quote from Francis Bacon, the founder of the scientific method. He once said that science is but an image of the truth. I'm not sure if we're seeing still the whole picture or the whole truth, but I do think that our research has revealed a glimpse of lipoprotein metabolism that we'll be able to build upon in the future to better see and understand how we can help our patients with lipoprotein and lipid disorders. And that is how science is supposed to work.